Well, good afternoon and from here at the Doolittle Leadership Center, and good morning out at in Las Vegas. Welcome to a very special edition of Air and Space Warfighters in Action. I'm your Air Force Association President, Orville Wright, and it's exciting today to welcome all of our audience to an amazing pilot, if you will, to meet an amazing pilot who leads our Thunderbirds today. In today's program, our guest speaker is Colonel John Brick Caldwell, commander of the Air Force Thunderbirds. Colonel Caldwell flies the team's number one jet and leads all Air Force demonstrations. In 19 years, I'm sorry, in the Air Force, he has more than 3,000 flight hours, and just yesterday completed 3,000 flight hours in the F-16. His time includes combat tours, some 600 plus combat missions, and he's a graduate of the Air Force Academy and of the prestigious U.S. Air Force Weapons School. As always, I want to start with a thank you to our generous sponsors, Collins Aerospace, Elbit America, GE Aviation, General Dynamics, L3Harris, Lockheed Martin, NextEra Energy, Oracle, the Pentagon Federal Credit Union, Pratt & Whitney, Raytheon, SAIC, and the Roosevelt Group. And we can't thank all of our sponsors enough for helping us spread the word about the incredible work of our nation's airmen and guardians. Colonel Caldwell, Brick, welcome again. And the stage is yours. And we can't thank you and the team enough for today and all that you do.
Well, General Wright, thank you so much for having me here. And thank you for everything that the Air Force Association does for the Air Force. You guys fulfill a vital role, I think, in keeping the force well taken care of, the advocacy, the scholarships. It's definitely a critical piece in making sure that we have the best air and space force in the entire world. So thank you for everything you do. I do want to mention something about the sponsors, because I live in a world, I execute my mission, that relies on sponsors and sponsorship in order to have air shows, in order to allow us to execute our mission. And I don't think people truly appreciate the struggles and the battles that these sponsors go through in order to secure funds to do this kind of stuff. You know, the way I see is it's service to our nation another way. And without sponsorships, without the sponsors, people believing in this mission, being passionate about it, we couldn't do half the stuff that we do. So to your sponsors who sponsor the AFA, thank you for your service to this country. Thank you for your service to the Air Force. And thank you for your service to this team. Because again, without you, we would not be able to execute our mission the way that we execute it today. I wanted to start with just some basic information on the team. I like to, whenever I speak to a group like this, just start with a basic primer. What is the Thunderbirds all about? What is our composition? What are we made up of? Where do we come from? Where are we going? I think that's always important. I know there's a lot of people in the crowd here who have a good understanding of what the Thunderbirds do and what their charter is, but I think it's always good just kind of start there. So if you will allow me, I just want to start with some basic information on the Thunderbirds and what our organization is comprised of. So first off, we have 135 personnel with 28 different AFSCs. We're a self-contained entity. The team has the ability to operate essentially on its own in austere environments. We have multi-capable airmen who perform multiple jobs in order to execute our mission, and we're able to go to essentially a bare base, civilian base, disconnected from any airfield, any Air Force presence, and generate fighter operations within an hour and sustain that for the course of almost 3 to 4 days. It's actually impressive to watch C-17 land and watch about 60 folks pile out of that thing. And it looks like organized chaos, but everybody's moving with a purpose, and we're able to generate aircraft lines within about an hour of hitting the deck. And we do that on a weekly basis. So we typically leave on a Thursday. We'll arrive at the show site. We'll set up for a practice on Thursday. We'll generate a fan flight on that day as well. We'll do another practice on Friday. We'll execute an air show on Saturday. On Sunday, we'll execute another air show. And then on Monday, we're going to redeploy or we'll deploy to the next show site and set up for follow-on operations from there. So when we start talking about adaptive basing, ACE concept, the Thunderbirds have been doing it for quite a while, and we're really good at it. Now, granted, we don't have the complexities of generating the air power munitions, but when it comes to basic aircraft operations, it's something that this team is very proud of, the fact that everybody here has to do their primary function and do it well, but then you have to learn how to do an additional duty, because that is the only way that the team can exist on the road and set up and run our operations. So when you take a look at it from that sense, we have very skilled technicians that are willing to do extra duty. And then in addition to that, we have to make sure that we have people who are capable of interacting with the civilian side, with with air show attendees, and we got to make sure they leave them with confidence and a good impression of the Air Force, because in a lot of cases, this may be the only time that that person gets to interact with anybody in the military. Some of the places we go to do not have a connection with a military base or military members. And that may be the only interaction that they'll have in their lifetime with anybody who wears a uniform. So it's an important mission that you have to be good at what you do. You have to be able to take on additional workload, and you got to have this thing called charm and charisma, bedside manner, whatever you want to call it, so that you can interact with people and they're left with a sense of confidence in the United States military and in the Air Force. And we do that every week for over 8 months for a show season. We'll be on the road over 240 days executing that mission. And it's just remarkable to watch these airmen function and perform in extreme conditions at times, austere locations, and make the mission happen despite not being connected to an Air Force base. It truly is remarkable. Our mission in the Thunderbirds is to recruit, retain, and inspire. And in order to do that, we selectively man this unit. So in order to have somebody who can do all those things that I talked about, we're very selective with who is going to join this team and wear this patch. Every single position is hand selected. We have folks who will apply. We go through a very rigorous screening process. And then if you're selected, you show up and you enter a Thunderbird patch program where you'll spend about 2 weeks where we evaluate you. It's a probationary period where you learn about the history of the team. You learn about the Thunderbird operations, some of the unique things about being a Thunderbird. And then it culminates in a patch ceremony where we give you a patch. So it is a very high VIS squadron. I would argue one of the highest VIS squadrons in the entire Air Force that is selectively manned, that's on the road 240 days out of the year. During that 240 days, we're going to perform for roughly 8 million people in a live crowd, but then millions more who will watch us through social media, through videos on the internet. So our reach is actually pretty phenomenal. And in fact, in 2020, during the America Strong missions, we had over 7 billion impressions, which is reactions from crowds just online, which somebody pointed out to us, there's not that many people in the world. That's because multiple people were posting over and over. But that just shows you the reach of the squadron and the connection that we can have with the civilians, with the airshow sites, with people in the communities. And we're able to get that message into areas that may be difficult to get to otherwise. The mission of the Thunderbirds is to recruit, retain, aspire. But the other thing that we do that's very important, and we don't advertise this, but it is in fact something that is very important about Thunderbirds, is that we instill confidence in the public and their military and our capability. We generate support. So a lot of folks see big budgets. They see us spending money on MDSs, on weapon systems, and they don't have any firsthand knowledge or experience of how that's actually working. Is that a worthwhile investment? And when they see the Thunderbirds perform, we're able to take combat capability and reduce it down into something that's consumable by your average civilian to where they can truly appreciate the technology that's represented in these aircraft and the skill of the pilots and the skill of the ground crew of the maintainers through the ground show. And that generates confidence and support. And when we see this, you know, when we execute this on the road, there's an overwhelming sense of pride that everybody in the crowd has because this is America's team. This team is a national treasure because we come from our own population. We are in these communities. We grew up, we entered the Air Force, and we joined this team. And so there's an overwhelming sense of pride that these folks have when they see the Thunderbirds perform because they feel connected to the team. And when we were at this last show, we had our maintenance group commander travel with us, and his family was there at the show site. It was after one maneuver we flew, which was the Diamond Purr, which is our closest formation that we fly in the show. We're 18 inches apart, the Diamond Pass and Review. It's flown from right to left of the crowd. And his response, I thought, was very appropriate, and it was, you know, it was very gratifying to hear. When he saw that maneuver flown, he turned to his son and said, "Man, I'm glad these guys are on our side." And I think that's important because that's the sentiment folks get when they see the Thunderbirds fly. They don't just see people flying loops or rolls. What they see is national capability in the Air Force. We can show these people a red flag vol. We could show them the assets going in and rolling back a mez, hitting the tanker, the force protection piece, the strike, the interdiction. We could show them that at the red flag headquarters. And I think the complexity and the skill would largely be lost on them. It would require some explanation. The great thing that we do is that we can present that same skill and that same execution in a way that they can consume, that they can process, and they can truly appreciate. And it is such a thrill to go on the road and to represent the United States Air Force, but really the military in general, by doing this job. It truly is phenomenal. I think that, you know, one of the interesting things to talk about in this discussion is some of the changes that have occurred on the team, some of the events that we've been through in the past 2 years since I've been the commander leader. And I think we'll get to that here in a second, but I think in order to get to that piece, I just want to talk a little bit about the history of the team and how we got to where we're at now, because there were some significant milestones that we achieved in the past 2 years. And I think it's worthy of talking about, because there's some good lessons just in organizational leadership and in culture. And I think it's worth a discussion here with this forum. When I first joined the team in 2018, we were in a little bit of a rough spot in the Thunderbirds. We had just been on the heels of three Class A's. We had a fatality. We had a commander that was removed from command. And so there was a desire to really get in and understand the organization and affect change if it was required. And that was kind of the charter when I showed up, was to let's just stabilize the system. Let's execute the 2019 show season. And let's just deliver a heart of the envelope season. It doesn't have to be great. We don't want it to be terrible. We just want it to be safe. We want it to be effective. But let's just stabilize the ship. Let's just stabilize the system. And let's get through 2019 and just make sure that we can put a mark in the W column. And that was kind of the goal. It was not to challenge established beliefs or thoughts, not to change the structure, not to change the demo. It was, can we just execute the basics very well and get through show season? Let's start the show. Let's end the show with the same number of fingers, eyeballs, toes that we started with in airplanes. And that was the goal. And in 2019, that was the mission, was to go out and put on great air shows, but let's just have a safe and effective season. There wasn't a whole lot of appetite at the time to really dig into the history of the team, to dig into some of the structural things that we got into later, to changing the demo. We just wanted to get through the season. We wanted to perform well with what we have known worked in the past. And that's what we did in 2019. Towards the end of 2019, we started realizing that there were some areas of the squadron that needed some work. And I did the best thing I could think to do at the time, and I say this a lot, I've never had an original idea in my life. As a matter of fact, that statement is not an original idea either. I stole that from Vader Dempsey, who I believe is who's on this call. So I phoned a friend. I started calling every former commander leader, and we had a series of discussions about their thoughts on the team, what needs to change, what was good in the past, what do you think will work in this situation. And we developed a pretty good friendship with a lot of the former commander leaders, over 17 surviving commander leaders. And I was able to talk to 15 of them. And I can tell you that even those who flew in the 60s through the 70s and 80s all had something to contribute. They had something to say about the operations in the Thunderbirds. After that discussion, I realized that the best thing to do next, the next step, was to bring these folks out here to Nellis to create something that I called the Commander's Leadership Forum, to create a forum where I could meet with these people in person, we could interact, and allow them the opportunity to provide some critiques, some feedback on the team, on the demo, on the structure, on our practices. Everything was on the table, which requires you to assume a little bit of humility there when you're inviting 15 folks who previously have done your job to come here and critique you on how you're doing. But we didn't have a forum like that in the past. We didn't have the ability in a productive way where these folks could provide critiques, and it was an appropriate setting, and it was an appropriate manner. And so we had to create that. And we did that. We brought them out in the spring of 2020 to watch our COMAC acceptance show here at Nellis. We had 15 commander leaders out on the flight line, watching me fly and lead the demo, watching me brief the team, watching us debrief, watching us interact. They saw our Thunderbird practices, our operating procedures, and we told them to give us a debrief, give us a critique on how we're doing. And it was pretty eye-opening, some of the critiques we received and some of the information that we got from that group. It was enough to where we realized there was some serious work that we needed to execute to get this team back to where we wanted it to be in precision formation flying, in precision aerial demonstration. And so we committed ourselves to that idea that we were going to work on trying to recapture some of these versions that we had in the past, versions of the team that we had in the past, recapture and try to sustain those versions as we start moving forward so that the team can continually get better and better. And then the pandemic hit. So as we were gearing up to start our 2020 show season and getting ready to institute some of these changes and start looking into it, as you all know, we entered into the world of the pandemic, and everything got put on pause. And naturally for us, we weren't quite sure how this was going to affect our show season. So we immediately took 2 weeks down to kind of figure out what was happening and how that was going to change operations and what we needed to adapt and overcome. And during that time, that's when obviously all the civilian shows started to cancel, and one by one, almost all of them canceled. And we were left with an air demonstration squadron that had no air shows to fly. So as we were in the midst of that, we were really struggling with what do we do during this time? What can we do to help? And while we were looking at that, we were just inspired by the the healthcare workers, the medical providers, first responders, at their determination, their grit, their dedication to fight the pandemic. And we really did. We wanted to help. We wanted to show some support from the teams, from the jet teams. And we had communications with the Blue Angels. They were interested in this as well. We knew that we wanted to do something together. The timing of it was very important. We wanted to make sure that it was appropriate when we did it, how we did it. And so that began the beginnings of America Strong, which was supported by our leadership, but it was a public, it was a display of support to the public. It was meant to inspire, it was meant to provide them some motivation and maybe just one moment of happiness in what is a pretty dreary situation. And so we wanted to start here in Las Vegas because this is our hometown. This is where we're from. Our wives go to work here. Our children go to school here. So we wanted to start here in Vegas to really kind of cement the team as part of the Vegas identity. And so we started here in Vegas with the first flyover saluting the frontline workers, the healthcare workers, medical providers. And it was received very well. You know, it was an exhausting mission, I can tell you. They were long sorties. They were stressful sorties. But at the end of the day, we climbed out of the jet. We were soaking in sweat. We were completely exhausted, but completely satisfied with what we did and being able to salute these folks who are in the trenches fighting the pandemic every single day. So it was an exhausting but incredibly rewarding experience. And then from there it grew to Colorado. We ended up executing America Strong over Colorado, and then the time came to where we wanted to bring it to the Eastern Seaboard. New York specifically was kind of the crown jewel of where we really wanted to get to, just based off of the time, and we knew that they really needed their spirits lifted. And the discussion there was to have the Blue Angels cover the southern half of the Eastern Seaboard, and the Thunderbirds would go to Langley, and we'd cover the northern half. But the teams were pretty adamant that we wanted to execute this in a joint fashion. We thought it was important to show the concept of we are in this together, and there was no better way of a visible display of American resiliency cooperation than having the two jet teams fly together, which had never been done before. This had never been done before. So it was a very aggressive plan, and it required us to go to Pensacola, not Langley. And we had to develop joint TTPs with the Blue Angels flying over the Gulf of Mexico, multiple days, multiple trips, trying to figure out how do you maneuver two Delta formations in close proximity to each other. I can tell you, it may look easy in the films, but it is not easy. It's not easy at all. It's like trying to drive two cruise ships within 30 feet of each other. You have to have coordination between the teams. You have to have joint TTPs. You have to have radio calls. I mean, it was a huge ordeal to get this to where it was presentable and it was safe, but we did it. And we spent long hours. These were 12-hour days working with our Blue Angel counterparts for over 3 weeks, TDY at Pensacola, which I can tell you, going TDY in the middle of a pandemic is not fun. It was not fun at all, because we could only go to the Blue Angels building and then to our building, and that was it. And so staring at your hotel wall for at night for hours on end is not that entertaining, but that was your only option for entertainment there. So we worked on these TTPs, we worked on joint execution, and we were able to go execute America Strong, which I think was enormous success. But what it did during that time was it really solidified our relationship with the Blue Angels, working with them for 3 weeks straight. And I'm talking, we parked next to each other, we walked into the same doorway at the same time in the morning, we filled up our cups of coffee, sat down at the desk together. I had the opportunity to hear and participate in every discussion that the commander of the Blue Angels, G. Kesselring, had. He got to participate in every conversation I had. And we really figured out each other's organization. And then rewinding back to the beginning of the season where we were set on effecting some change in the squadron, the piece with the Blue Angels, the relationship with the Blue Angels, really facilitated that. Because once we figured out their organization, it really helped us understand our organization. And so you were in a unique position after America Strong, in that we had come to a spot where we fully understood our demo. We had used technology in ways that we had never used technology before. So we understood the mechanics of the demo, I think, better than we had in the past. We had developed this relationship with those who had served in this uniform in the past through our advisory board that we created, the CLF, and then just opening those lines of communication really enables to help understand the history of this team, the history of the maneuvers, the history of our process and operating procedures. And then we had this relationship with the Blue Angels where we really understood their organization. We understood their strengths, their weaknesses, their challenges. And those three things combined with one other major fact, that we're going to have a third year. So you take those three items, which are all unique in their own right, but then adding the third year really enabled us to dig in and do something productive with that. And that's what moved us into the last half of 2020. which was executing very basic air shows. There was a decision we were about to make of not flying any air shows in 2020 because of the pandemic, but we decided that it was worthwhile because we wanted to demonstrate the resiliency of the air show community, the resiliency of our team. And so it's important for us, even though we didn't fly a lot of air shows, that we do something, that we fly some air shows just to show that we will, even though we take a hit, we're going to get up, we're going to keep going. And that was what we did. But following the end of our show season in 2020, we had to have some tough conversations on the team because we had this knowledge and we had this opportunity. And I was talking to General Wright, and I told him that the temptation when you're given a third year is that it's real easy to just put the squadron on cruise control. We can achieve the same level of proficiency with about a quarter of the energy expended because of our proficiency and because of the fact that we've been doing this for so long. And it was a decision that we had to make because the third year on this team is exhausting. But everybody on the team was dedicated to this idea that we are going to improve the squadron. We're going to use this third year in a productive way to make the Thunderbirds better. And that required us to really make sure that we had that commitment that we're not only going to put the squadron on cruise control, we're actually going to work harder than we ever did in the past. And that's a lot to ask of a team. And it really kind of cut to the core of who are we as a Thunderbird? What do we really care about? And it was, you know, kind of a, what I always say, you always have to start with who you want to be before you decide what you're going to do. And it was really a character test for everybody that do you have the dedication, determination to do this? And the answer was yes. And so we started looking at making some changes. I can tell you that we have initiated 59 separate initiatives since that time. 59. That sounds like a lot, but I can tell you that just one of those initiatives is changing the demo. And changing that, when I say changing the demo, we actually changed 6 forms of the demo: the high, low, flat, and then the high, low, flat, 5-ship show. That's just one of them. These are massive undertakings that we decided to jump into, all facilitated by our knowledge of the Blue Angels, knowledge of our history, our relationship with the alumni, the third year, and then understanding our demo. So it was definitely a massive amount of work that we were looking at. But the first thing we kind of set out to do was to change the demonstration. The demonstration had become slightly hodgepodge over the years, as we had made onesie twosie changes without really looking at the whole kind of picture, the big picture of it all. And so the first thing we want to do is change the demo. And what the critical thing that we looked at when changing the demo was we want to turn this from a series of athletic maneuvers like the Harlem Globetrotters to more of a performance like the Cirque du Soleil, where it has themes, it has coherency, it has things that make sense in it that we can tie music and narration into. And that's what we did. We redesigned the show with the performance in mind, all at the aim of the customer experience, the person on the ground. What are they seeing? What are they watching? Does it make sense to them? Is it entertaining? And is there a consistent logical theme to what we're doing? And that's how we redesigned the demo. But we started with what I told the guys is basic execution. Because the temptation, again, with redesigning the demo is to create new maneuvers or create more dramatic maneuvers. And what we decided was really what we need to do is execute the basics very well. Execute the basics in an exceptional manner. And that is how we will impress the audience. And that is how we can get to that version of the team that we're looking forward to getting to. And the thing that we always keep in mind is that we always believe the golden era of the Thunderbirds is ahead of us. The best version of this team is ahead of us. And so in that sense, it is how do we orient ourselves in light of that belief? Because that's the belief we started with, which is it's not about the destination, it's about the journey. And that was the cultural change that we had to have on this team, is that we are going to have to work and continue to work. We're never going to win the Thunderbirds. We're never going to finally arrive to some grand version of this team, and then we can sit back and relax. It is always going to be a struggle. And just like formation flying, you have to want it, and you have to work at it, and you have to work hard. Formation flying, I always tell these guys, is a test of character, because you have to fight for every single inch. It's easy to relax and slide out of position a little bit. You have to fight and want to be in there. And that was really what was going on in the squadron, was a cultural change. It was a change in the hearts and minds of people who wear this uniform and do this job, a belief that we represent excellence in everything that we do. And the civilian population craves excellence in any form that they can find it. And that was the mark of success for us, was, are we executing in an excellent manner? Are we flying in an excellent manner? And excellence is what drove and motivated us at that time. And it's what drives and motivates us to this day. So all said and done, 59 initiatives. We redesigned the high, the low, and the flat show. We invented a couple new maneuvers to supplement the themes that we were going along with. And I can tell you that the team is stronger than ever now, but we are looking forward to the future. So we're changing the way we train. We've introduced virtual reality training. We've changed our training syllabus. It's more adaptive. And we believe that the next team is always going to be better than us. That is always our belief. We have to make the next team better than us, because that is the true measure of our success, is did we make enable the next team to follow us even better so we can continue on that trajectory. John Wright, I know I've been rambling for a while, so I'll stop there and just say that the amount of changes, the journey that we've been on this team has been remarkable. It's been an honor to be on the Thunderbirds during this time. The pandemic was definitely a challenge for us, but I was very proud of the team to find a new and innovative way to use this team that in a way that was still effective. And I was, I think it truly is a demonstration of how resilient this team is, how resilient the Air Force is, and pressing forward despite even some of the worst conditions that you can imagine for a team like this. And so overall, that gives me hope for the future as we press forward with the Thunderbirds, that I think we're in good hands. And I think we're going to have a great team in the future, one that we can all be proud of. And it's been a pleasure serving on this team. And thank you again for letting me speak a little bit here with this forum.
Thanks, Brick. Inspiring. Air Force core values articulated and actualized. Integrity, service before self, and certainly excellence in all that we do. And the Air Force Association is going to try harder now that we've been inspired by such a terrific leader. I hope you write a book just on leadership, because you've hit all the high points. Well, we're going to go to a few more questions here and interact a bit in the next half hour or so. And again, I know you're busy and appreciate your time. Before we go to the next question, though, could you take a bit of time and talk about the combat experience, officer and enlisted, that you have on your team as you look forward to taking really the exemplary leadership development opportunity that your team has had into combat operations as you leave the team after a three-year tour or so. So your own experience and then experience of your team. This is your team's about combat air forces and combat air forces capability, and really Department of the Air Force's capability. So over to you for a few thoughts on that, and then we'll go to Brian Everstein, who's our AFA terrific reporter, for a question. So Brian, get ready for the next question. So Rick, back to you for just a few minutes.
Yes, sir. So I think that, combat experience is something that really kind of frames what we're doing here. Seeing the force in action in combat, whether it's troops in contact, employing ordnance in Iraq or Afghanistan, my personal experience, the importance of this mission, I think, is really kind of exemplified in that. And it really helped me understand that what we're trying to do is take something like a combat employment, which requires an incredible amount of dedication and skill to do it correctly. And we do it skillfully and correctly every time. That we have the opportunity on this team to translate that to something that we can provide for the folks who are watching the show, so that they can truly appreciate that without actually having to see a GB-38, engagement. However, we put elements in the show that is supposed to give that element of surprise, the attack. We have a lot of, in the new show, we have a section called Speed and Motion, and it's all about showing the power of the machines, how intimidating the aircraft can be, and what a sense of relief when we do a sneak pass or we do a four-ship rapid recovery and you have four 229s in full afterburner over the crowd when they're not expecting it. That feeling you get and the relief you have that these are the good guys, that feeling is derived from, we want people to appreciate what your men and women are doing out in the field, out in combat every single day. For me personally, I've learned a lot about airmanship, about flying, about precision execution in my time in combat with roughly 680 hours of combat time. And the team itself is very experienced in when it comes to combat. I think we have something on the order of 2,500 total combat hours in the eight pilots who are on the team, with somewhere on the order of 500 weapons employments overall. So it's a very experienced team. It's just kind of the nature that we've found ourselves in with the global war on terror. But we have a lot of combat experience. And again, that helps us really frame our mind with what we're here and why we're doing this. I have a GBU-38 nose cone that I cover that I keep in my office that I look at every time when I walk out, because it's a good reminder of that's where I came from and that's where I'm going to go. This is a temporary duty assignment where I can, I have the opportunity to show people what our true combat capability is in a different format. But at the end of the day, that is what we're showing is true combat capability.
Yeah. Thanks. If we could go now to Brian Everstein for a question, and then if you all shoot, we've got, I think, 100 plus people up on the net today already, in addition to those who will watch. You'll end up reaching 1 million people here today based on the feedback we've gotten with our strategic comms capability recently. At any rate, raise your hand. Use the raise hand function. And after Brian, we'll go to a few other members of the audience today for questions. Thanks.
Hey, Colonel, thanks so much for taking the time and taking my question. I really appreciate it. I was hoping you could talk a little bit more about some of the changes and what's new. You had mentioned 59 separate initiatives. Can you maybe highlight just a handful more, or just a couple kind of outside of the demo itself, some of those initiatives? And secondly, I understand you have a new tail that you brought in. It was a former F-16 with weapons school. Can you talk about the background of why, basically what prompted this and sort of what you learned bringing on that new aircraft?
Yeah, no, that's a good question. So let me address the first one. It would take me a long time to read all the initiatives. I'll try to hit some highlights. And two major categories, I'll speak to a couple categories here. So the first one is changes in the demo. So we talked about changing the show types. We changed the new show sequence times six. So there were six changes there on the show sequence. We added new maneuvers, roughly about eight different types of maneuvers. We have new music and narration. So we went to a professional studio and we had them evaluate our show. We actually had them come to one of our shows at the end of 2020. And we said, what do you think about our music and narration? And these are professionals. These are folks who work at Universal Studios and Disney. And we said, you know, if you were designing our show, how would you integrate the music and narration? And that was very educational for us. And we worked with them to get it right. How long is the right amount of time? What's a good length for the ground show? So we changed the music narration. We changed the ground show. We changed our shutdown procedures. We have new takeoff maneuvers. We changed our EOR procedures. We rewrote our ops manual. We instituted a lot of technology in our demo for our debrief. So now we fly with GoPros to monitor formation, and we use that when we're debriefing. We have our GPS lines that can show us exactly where we flew over the ground. We did hardware modifications to the jet to support that. We have a DVR system that is specific to the Thunderbirds that allows us to very quickly transfer the data to the computer so that we can have a three-dimensional picture of what happened in that demo. So at any moment, we have eliminated all the subjectiveness from it. It is cold, hard data that we can look at, and it's very unemotional. You either did it right or you did it wrong. We have the data here to prove it. And that's what really made the team, I think, more effective and better. But some other changes just in the material solution side is that we instituted the Bad Wolf DVR system, a new lap belt for our pilots, because we do a lot of inverted flying, and the stock F-16 belt was insufficient and causing injuries. We've changed little things like changing our gloves and visors. We upgraded to the newest suite for the F-16, which is M72, which was not an easy process because the new version has auto GCAS, which turns out we cannot function with auto GCAS. I went out and did a test sortie, and the first maneuver, it tried to recover me. And even in its basic mode, its lowest thresholds, it was not compatible. So we had to work with the developmental folks, with the requirement folks, to get an OFP that was going to be compatible with us. And I could go on. There's a lot of things structurally that we changed, but I think suffice it to say, I don't think there's an area in the squadron we didn't look at or make some type of change. And I believe there's a second question in there. Can you restate it?
Yeah, about you converted a F-16, I think it was from the weapons school.
That's right. So, you know, as I talked through a little bit of the history when I first showed up, it's no secret that we had crashed three airplanes in the 3 years preceding when I showed up. So we were down on the number of aircraft that we needed. In 2018 and 2019, we were executing with seven aircraft on the road, which we typically take eight because of aircraft availability. So there was no doubt that we needed to get back to 13 is the number of airplanes that we need in order to fly our demo and to fly it without contingency shows. And so we had to slowly get those airplanes back. So we took some from the weapons school. We also ended up taking one from South Carolina Air National Guard. And then we decided one of the other initiatives that we started this year was we did our own in-house conversion. I used my maintainers to convert it from a gray jet to a Thunderbird jet, which is the first time that's ever been done. And that was a huge success. It saved us jet availability in the order of months, just being able to do it here in-house, get the painting done here in-house. It was man hours out of hide, but it was totally worth the investment because we were able to return that jet service. And now we're back to almost to full strength. We've got one jet sitting in the hangar right now that's being converted by my folks, and it should be ready in the next couple months. And then we'll be up to full strength at that point.
Great. Thank you.
Brian, and thanks, Rick. Let's go to General John Jumpers up, our former Chief of Staff of the U.S. Air Force.
Hey, Brick. Hey, Orville. Good to see you, Orville. Brick, you might just give us a minute or two on the importance of wing commander participation in helping you and the system get the right kind of candidates to be the demo pilots, and especially when we're looking for replacement leaders and the right personalities, the right experience, and how important that is.
Yes, sir. It's critical. And so, the story of how I got to this job, just as a vignette, is that it was General Holmes communicating to the wing commanders that we're looking for somebody who kind of has the skill set, who kind of has this record. And it was the wing commanders who first gave me the idea that this was a possibility. I didn't think being a Thunderbird was, I didn't think that was something I just didn't think that was an opportunity that I would have. And so it was really their leadership of seeing potential in me that gave me the idea that this is something you could do. And Vader's online here, he was there during that whole process. And that's how I got to the team. And so what I found was that there's people who may be reluctant to join the team, but they're the right people. And that requires the wing commanders to communicate, because they have the authorities, they have the ability to make things happen that we can't have, that just doesn't happen at the squadron commander and the AO level. They know their folks. They have to truly appreciate the difficulty of this job and the importance of this mission. And then we have a responsibility to make sure we're putting the best people into this role, because it is so visible and it is such a tough job. This, for all these folks, the mission is unlike anything you did in the gray jet world. I mean, there's some similarities, but overall, it takes somebody who is a capable aviator, somebody who is autonomous, can do their mission with minimal oversight, and somebody who can survive the demands of being on the road for as long as we're on the road. It can integrate in with the team, a very close team, a high performing team, and then still go out after a 12-hour day and interact with some kid or with somebody who's at the air show and make them feel like you were there just for them, to make them feel like you flew the whole air show for them. So the bottom line is we rely on the wing commanders being involved and being responsive to make sure that we get the composition of this team right. Because when we do the diagnosis on when things go wrong on this team, it always goes back to the hiring process, which goes back to what kind of candidates did we have? And so that requires some active leadership, I think, on the part of wing commanders and group commanders to make sure that they're poking the right people or they're suggesting to the right people that they give the team a shot.
Okay, back up. Well, this is almost, Rick, you've generated a family reunion here. So we've got retired Lieutenant General Tony Rock up. And then how about after that, Linda McMahon, who's our AFA State of Virginia president. And then there's a couple more great names that have popped up here. Greg Idy. So there's three heroes of mine. So we'll start with Tony Rock.
Thanks a lot, Orville. And Brick, thanks to you and to the entire team for everything you do for our Air Force. One of the things I'd like to ask you about is whether or not you get to express in subjective terms the value for recruiting that the Thunderbirds have as our ambassadors. You have a lot of impact on the international stage, but certainly in the national stage, as we try to get the best and brightest of America's youth in to be airmen and space guardians, you are a very, very visible part of that. So do you get a chance to articulate to the naysayers who are always looking for that next big budget cut, whether it's NASCAR, the Thunderbirds, or whatever it is? And then how does that also tie into the growth of diversity and inclusion as the team continues to increasingly represent what our force looks like and what America looks like? Thanks.
Yes, sir. And that's a great question. And I can tell you that the last piece there, the current team, the 2020 team, is the most diverse team that we've ever had in the Thunderbird history. So I think we're doing a pretty good job in getting the demographic slice right, that we're representative of the force in all the different cultures and values that are out there. So I'm really proud of that effort, that we've had people from each of those areas who have raised their hand and wanted to be a Thunderbird, and we've been able to give them the opportunity. And they speak to those communities in ways that, some of us cannot. So it's given us access, incredible recruiting access to some areas. And we send our people on the road to go back to their hometowns, to go back to forums, and to really generate interest in the Air Force, to generate interest in the military in general. Now, when it comes to recruiting, this is, in my personal opinion, I think the Thunderbirds are the the single most powerful recruiting tool that we have. And that's not just my opinion. I know that was General Levitt's opinion when she was in charge of AFRS. And we did something I thought that was fairly innovative, is that we worked with General Levitt to get a recruiter. Believe it or not, we didn't have a recruiter in the Thunderbirds on the team. There was no recruiter on the team. So we worked with AFRS to give us a body where we actually have a recruiter now that is here in the squadron and creates these opportunities to go out and do recruitment. And whenever the pandemic hit, we were still engaging with the community and doing recruiting efforts. We were doing virtual engagements, doing Zoom town halls. We had Facebook Lives. So we were very active in the recruiting world, even though we weren't turning a wheel at an air show. And I think if you go back to 1983, when we had, 1982, we had, unfortunately, the Diamond crash. But in 1983, when the team was kind of on the chopping block and we were transitioning to the F-16, General Creech did a study on the impact of the team. And it was something phenomenal that 80% of folks who were in the force had indicated that the Thunderbirds in some way, shape or form, and the Blue Angels had motivated them, inspired them, or was part of the calculus of joining the force. Now, I don't know what those numbers are today, but I can tell you that there's something there. There's something there to that. There's a reason why this team has existed in this way, and it provides a service that I think is absolutely valuable and critical to that interaction piece with the civilians. As I told you, we go to some communities where this may be the only time they interact with anybody in the military. And that's what starts the conversation. That's what starts the interest. And it's almost impossible to track every single one of those, but I can tell you in Fort Smith, Arkansas, in 1986, it worked for me. When I saw Roger Riggs and the team fly for the first time, I was hooked. That was it. So if you went back and you track that data, how many of us are here or how many of us serve because of something that inspired us, motivated us, and it was just the initial kind of introduction to the military that did it for you. So very important. We're very sensitive to the importance of recruiting and what we do for recruiting, and I think we're very effective at it.
Great. Let's go next question to Linda McMahon, again, our AFA volunteer leader, the president of our Virginia chapter. So, Linda, hope you have either a question or I'm sure some encouragement for our Thunderbird lead.
Thank you very much, General Wright. Colonel Caldwell, thank you for your time today. Earlier, you spoke about the combat experience you and your team has primarily gained through Southwest Asia's operations and the positive effects that had and results for what you had to do with the Thunderbirds. As we withdraw from Afghanistan, what concerns do you have regarding the impact to the Thunderbirds' future in those areas?
Well, I think that, if you look at the history of the team, there's been plenty of times where we've had outstanding versions of the Thunderbirds, and it's been at a time where, we had peace, although, it was during a Cold War, but we had peace. So I think appreciation for the combat mission is something that is just in the culture of the Air Force. And you always have those folks who have been there, who have done that. And we pass those values and the importance of that on to our next generation. And that's something that I think is going to always be in our DNA as Air Force members, as fighter pilots. It's always going to be something that is going to be on the forefront of your mind, that the reason why we do this, the reason why this is important, is because at the end of the day, we're charged with being tactical experts and being the very best at whatever it is we do. We will not accept anything other than being the very best. And that attitude is one that's born out of conflict. And I think that is something we pass on culturally to our folks. So as we withdraw in combat time and employments, start to, slope off, I think we'll still be able to capture that fighting spirit that has made us such a successful Air Force. Now, I will admit, having firsthand knowledge of it, you appreciate, you understand, you appreciate the significance of tactical perfection. But I do think we do a fantastic job of replicating in our training. I think we do a great job of replicating that in who we continue to promote up the chain, who we continue to push for upgrades. We always identify those people who have the characteristics that have that warrior spirit that I think is important for us to be successful in combat. And that will always be something that we look for on this team, so that we have that connection with why we are really here and what are we representing, who are we representing. That's something that I think we'll always be able to answer.
This is Thank a great you. Discussion. Let's go to Greg Idy, a former 57th Wing Commander, and then Bobby Oates, who's our AFA chapter president for the Thunderbird chapter in Nellis.
Hey, Rick, number one, thank you very much for taking the time today and explaining your view on life. Where do you see the Thunderbirds in 5 years from now?
Well, that's a good question, sir. As I said before, I truly believe that the team needs to understand, and we have to appreciate that the golden era is always ahead of us. And I think that is what we're trying to instill as the culture here, is that it is work. We're going to have to continually work. So where I see the team 5 years from now is I'm hoping that they're going to take some of the initiatives that we have and they're going to make it better. So what I see is that the demos have become, I think we're going to be able to fly it in a more precise manner. I really think they're going to be able to have a more entertaining show than the one you see today. I think we're going to continue to grow. I think the team's going to become more mature in the sense that we are finding ways that we can police ourselves, that we can teach ourselves to grow, that we can become more of a team. Some of the initiatives that we're starting is to create that team atmosphere, that high performance team earlier in the training season. And so I think that what you're going to see is a better demo. I think you're going to see a tighter team. I think you're going to see that it is literally going to impress people with the precision of the demo, with the ground show. I really see us improving in all these areas that I think that we've been trying to improve upon. Structurally, I don't know where the team is going to stay in terms of is it always going to be a former squadron commander taking command? Or are you going to see another 06 running the team? I don't know about that, but I do think that we're going to hire with a very dedicated purpose of making sure we're getting the right people who appreciate that we're going to continually work, never put this squadron on cruise control. Good is not good enough. And that's an attitude that we have to fight, that, you know, if I'm 3 feet away from this guy's wingtip or 18 inches, the crowd's not going to notice it. What I found is that we just cannot accept mediocrity in this organization. If you do, bad things happen. So I think you're going to see that the squadron is going to continually get better. And I think the culture is going to become more robust in that performance matters, and that we're going to work hard to continually get better and better. And I think we will.
Great. We could go to Bobby Oates, our AFA chapter president. And oh, by the way, the state president and the regional president for our Air Force Association. I know, Bobby, you're always recruiting. So here's a great opportunity for our local chapter leader and as well as, I'm sure, a couple of plugs for our Air Force Association. Bobby.
Well, thank you again, sir, for talking. I see you when you take off every day from my office window up here. I live right outside the gate, so it's always a thrill to see you, and especially when you're starting a practice season, watching you go from 2 to 3 to 4, that's always fun. But I would really like for the chapter to get more involved with the Thunderbirds, but I know you're always on such a busy schedule, but it's something that we can work on. And I heard that you're going to be shortening the season. You're going to be ending up in October, finishing in October coming soon, versus going through the middle of November.
I believe this season we're going to go all the way through November. Our last show, I may be wrong here. My number 8 advanced pilot narrator is the one who's been working the schedule, but we added Tucson at the end, and I know that's squarely in November. And then we're going to do a Thunderbird appreciation show here in mid November, I think around November 14th. So at least for this team, we're planning on flying air shows through November. Now, in the past, we've had discussions about shortening the season to end it around Halloween, 1st November. And that was because we had such a heavy training bill that we had to pay for a new commander leader. So there was some discussion about trying to create some more white space in our training season. And one of the ideas was to shorten the show season. Now, we love to get on the road and we love to fly, but I have to tell you, having done this now for I'm going into my third year of doing this, November is not a great time to be flying air shows, because that's when the weather is changing and shifting. We've got 100 knots of headwind anywhere we're going. We have ice storms. There's just some bad weather phenomenons. We end up getting to an air show site. It's cold, it's rainy, we don't turn a wheel, and it just frustrates people. So depending on where those air shows are at, we found that, doing an air show in November in the middle of Texas is not a great idea. And so we were trying to be smarter about where's a good place to send the aircraft at the end of the season. If we're going to do November shows, we got to make sure it's going to be an area that's going to be kind of free of that weather phenomenon. But in November, taking 8 aircraft cross country can be challenging. It can be dangerous. And lots of times it ends up with us getting to a place that has a weather system that's not going to allow an air show to occur anyways. And then there's an immense amount of pressure when we get there to fly an air show, and that could lead to some poor decisions. So we definitely were looking at shorting it, but I can tell you this season, we're going to fly through November. And based off some of the changes we made to training, introducing virtual reality training, introducing a little bit more risk acceptance on letting the new folks fly together, we might have been able to square the corner on keeping November as an air show month but I can tell you, me personally, I've pushed my advanced pilot narrator, the folks who run the shows, to target areas that we know are going to have favorable weather, so we don't have to put the team into a dangerous situation where they're battling, you know, winter weather systems and landing at 200-foot ceiling minimums.
Yeah, especially like here at Nellis, it's good weather in November for air shows versus in May.
Absolutely. And so that's why we're doing Tucson at the end of the season, because we know that they always have good weather. It's a short trip for us, so that's an easy one. So the West Coast shows we kind of favor on in the November season. But you got to work with the air show organizers, because they have certain schedules and timelines that they have to adhere to based off permissions and authorities. So we just got to work with them. But hopefully that answers your question. But the answer is we're going to continue to fly through November.
Sounds good. I look forward to meeting all your team and coming out and spending some time with you all. Thank you.
Great.
And thank you, Bobby. Thanks for all you do for our Air Force Association. Begin to wrap up here a bit before we go to our small group session, Brick. Could you talk a little bit about the next three or four shows and how, as the lead, you look sort of, I guess, really strategically and operationally at those show sites, size of crowd, the unique operating environment. And I know those are certainly the next three or four shows are on your mind. Just knowing what a great leader you are. But the other thing we'd like to do is, as you talk through this, we're going to ramp up. We need to ramp up our AFA support to get the word out across our chapters to motivate even larger crowds. And nowadays, it's not just the crowd that shows up, but how we work with you to continue to live stream the inspiring, exciting content of your show. So please, we'll wrap up. And then I've got a small presentation to give. And then you'll have the last word before we go to the small group. Please.
All right. Well, you know, when you start looking forward at the show schedule, the first thing that I always kind of look at, the first lens that I kind of view the show schedule at, is what are the unique hazards that are associated with that show site? What are the opportunities? But mainly the first thing I want to take a look at is what's the construction of the TFR? What is the show site composition? Where can we potentially have some areas that we need to minimize our risk? Where is the greatest area of risk? So those are always things as a commander that I'm always looking at. And it starts with the cross country. It starts with how we get the jets from point A to point B, because what we have found on this team is that you cannot let your guard down for a moment. Every single mission, every single second of those missions can be life or death on this team, particularly when we're flying the demonstration. So I'm always safety conscious as the first thing I start thinking about strategically, because if you want to talk about a strategic failure, if we have a red, white, and blue jet sitting in a field somewhere because somebody punched out, or worse, we have fatality, then that is going to do more damage than anything else I can think of. So we have to think from a safety mindset from the get-go to avoid that strategic catastrophe. So I'm always concerned about what are the hazards of getting there, what are the hazards of operation, and those are the things that I'm always going to focus on first and foremost. And every show is different. Every show has their own unique challenges that you have to be dialed into and you have to be aware of. And how aggressive you fly the show and how well you can fly the show really depends on the show site. And that's the second thing that I have to look at is, we would love to be flying 200 feet off the deck, 18 inches apart within 500 feet of the crowd line, because that is a visceral experience for people. It's an intimate experience when you can do that. But I can't do that all the time because of the show site setup. Flying around in Milwaukee, you know, I'm a pilot, we're turning around skyscrapers, you know, we got to keep a respectable, healthy distance, which means it's going to force some maneuvers a little bit further away from the crowd. And you just got to accept that. So the first thing we take a look at is, what are the hazards associated with getting there, setting up operations, which there can be a lot. How do we mitigate those? How do we minimize the risk? And then how do we prepare to fly the best possible show that we can fly given the challenges of that particular TFR? And sometimes the TFR, it's not just the TFR, sometimes it's the personalities associated with running that show. We have FAA inspectors, evaluators, air boss, air show organizers. We'll have civic and community leaders. There's all people there that you have to take in consideration when you go to a show site. So there's a lot of strategic thinking that goes into flying an air show that you don't really get into those conversations with folks until you're sitting in this seat and you got to consider it. What is going to be the political optic of this? You know, how aggressively can we fly the show? Are we going to have an ICE, you know, an inspector that's going to have, cause some problems for us and try to, you know, restrict maneuvers or change the sequence. So we're always kind of trying to figure out the show site. Each one is unique and it requires a lot of study and development. And aside from that, we want to fly a great show. We want people to have their breath taken away. We want them to go out and be absolutely amazed that we can take these aircraft with these pilots and these maintainers and do something that is truly inspiring. Because when we do that, I know for a fact the people in the crowd, and I've seen it, when they see us fly some of these maneuvers, in that moment, anything is possible. And you know, this can be young, it can be old, But in that moment, when they see us fly a truly spectacular show or maneuver in its most basic form, they truly believe anything is possible. And that's the inspiration piece that we do. And that's the part that I really love. And so that's why we put a lot of energy into studying the show site so that we can make sure that people walk away with that experience, because that's very important. Because they walk away with that, they love their country, they love their military, they love their Air Force, and they're just filled with an immense sense of pride, and anything is possible for them after that.
Well, once again, you inspire. Thank you. As we close out today and go to our small group, thanks to all who joined us today. And thanks again, especially to our sponsors. As AFA remains committed every day to supporting every airman and guardian and more dominant air and space forces. It's also an honor today to recognize in a very small way the incredible initiative of the Thunderbirds and the Blue Angels to put together the America Strong operation and provide direct and I think inspiring encouragement for our first responders and our medical professionals during the global pandemic of 2020. No doubt your overflight of many US cities brought optimism in many ways to hundreds, if not thousands, of Americans across our nation. So we put together a very small tribute. This is a personally autographed copy, autobiography of Eddie Rickenbacker. And his signature's in here. And just as this incredible air warrior, national hero of our time in this nation from World War I to World War II, the initiative and the courage of the Thunderbirds is just tracks in the same way. And the trials and the triumphs of Eddie Rickenbacker have no doubt and thrilled and inspired Americans for decades. And that's exactly, Greg, what you and your team are doing today. So again, I hope many of our audience will be able to catch one or more of your shows this year. Ocean City this weekend, exciting. By the way, how many thousands do you expect? Do you have a crowd estimate?
Normally at our beach shows, we'll have well over 200,000 people. It's really tough to calculate because they normally just define that in the primary viewing area. But I can tell you doing these shows, we'll have hundreds and thousands of people from 5 miles out all the way to 5 miles on the other side. So it's typically into the millions when we get to beach shows.
Incredible. Well, with that, closing comments, and then we'll shift to the small group. Please, Greg, and thank you so much again for your leadership, for being with all of us today. And, fly hard, fly safe.
Yes, sir. I just wanted to say, first off, the presentation there, that's incredibly humbling. We set out to do this mission because we were honoring other people. The people who truly needed to be honored, in our opinion. And it was a lot of hard work on both the teams. I think they were dedicated to the mission. They were passionate about it. And these missions were tough. I mean, they were 7-8 hours flying formation for 45 minutes at a time, which is what we're not used to do. We'd come back and our arms would be completely numb because we fly with full nose down trim, 25 pounds of stick force the entire time we're flying. And so when we come back, our arms would be numb. We'd be completely tired, be hungry, we'd be exhausted, but we were so proud to be able to do a service to our country and our community. So I feel, we appreciate the award, but we're humbled and honored because the true heroes and warriors were the folks who were out there on the front lines. I do think that the airmen that I saw in America Strong on the Blue Angels and the Thunderbirds, if you could see them in action, I think you would be incredibly inspired by just their dedication to the mission. Watching them find a problem and then find a solution to that problem and press forward was absolutely just, it was incredible. It was, and it's us, it's our people. It's our airmen doing that. And we didn't push them. We didn't force them to do it. They did it on their own. We didn't cancel a single line in all of America Strong. We didn't lose a single tanker in all of America Strong. And it wasn't because it just happened. It was because people believed in the mission and they worked hard. We had folks staying up to midnight preparing mission materials for a mission that was going to be executed at 6 a.m. the next morning. We had people drive across the country to get us the correct crypto key so we get on the network so that we can have protection, safety, and some C2. I mean, just the stories that came out of on the Air Force and the Navy side are absolutely amazing. So I appreciate, truly appreciate the recognition that you provided both the teams, but I would have to turn that around to the men and women who flew those missions, the maintainers who turned the wrenches, the PA troopers who were up all night trying to get the messaging right. It truly was an incredible military effort, a joint effort. And, I was humbled to be their leader, to be a part of that. And thank you, sir, for recognizing that. And then overall to the group, I just want to say thank you all for what you do. I rely on folks like this, General Jumper, General Idy, discussions with them, people who are, it takes a special person to jump back into the world of Air Force problems. Because you all dealt with it already on your own watch in some way, shape, or form. And I say this of our alumni as well. I really value and honor the people who are willing to jump back into the world of Thunderbird problems and take on some of these challenges and provide us some mentorship, provide us some direction and participation. But that's what makes this country great. That's what makes our Air Force great. That's what makes the Thunderbirds great. So thank you all for your interest, for being part of this, for being part of the AFA. I think this is what makes our country so incredible. So you have continued service, even though you have done your time, you're continuing to serve, and we are all benefiting from it. I would just encourage you to continue to do that. And anything we can do to help improve the ranks, to increase the numbers, we want to take part in it, because we see the value of this organization, and we're so humbled and honored to be here today and be part of this. So thank you, sir, for the opportunity. And with that, I'll leave it at that. Please come and see an air show this year. We really want you to see it, because what you're going to see there is, it's an exciting demo, but what you're seeing is, it's a culture change in the Thunderbirds, and we're very proud of the progress we made. We're proud of what we've done, but it was a team effort. So everybody contributed to it, and we'd love you to come out and see the show and appreciate the effort and the process that the team's been through. And now please come out, see the show, and enjoy kind of where we're at.